Looking for Eliza, written by Leif Arbuthnot and read by Julia Franklin. The moral right of the author has been asserted. This performance is owned by Isis Audio. Chapter 1. The moment Ada walked into the small supermarket on Iffley Road, she knew something sinister had happened to it since her last visit. Had the aisles moved 3 inches to the left? Had some zealous store manager set up a deli counter at the back, bunching up everything else in the shop? She grabbed a loaf of rye bread from the baked goods section by the flowers and walked vigilantly down the fruit aisle. Something was very definitely off. She remembered visiting an earthquake room with Michael years ago in some London museum. There was a mock-up of a greengrocer's on level 2, with a shopping trolley, and all these fake cereal boxes everywhere. And every few minutes, the whole thing would start shaking terrifically to give visitors a sense of what being in an earthquake was like. Adrian found the room mildly boring. Michael loved it, and stood there for a long time, grinning along with the 7-year-olds whenever the quake began. At any moment, she felt, this shop, too, would start shivering, its tins threatening to spring from their shelves. This time, Michael wasn't around to smile at the tremors. Ada squared her shoulders, trying to work out what was different. At the end of the aisle, where Brayburns turned to spring onions and leeks, each in their own solitary plastic pocket, she saw at last what had happened. At the back of the shop, where Ada usually lined up with her basket by the chewing gum and snack bars, wondering whether it would be Adul at the till today, or Fatima, or very possibly Kim, hopefully not, there were 6 machines. They looked like cramped cash points. They were self-checkouts, each gleaming with 21st century newness. Lasers for barcode scanning, glowing from their bellies like demonic eyes. Ada froze. So, the human tills had been replaced. Adul was nowhere to be seen, nor was Fatima. Kim was there, though, standing by the last machine in the row. She looked more glum than Ada had ever seen her. In beige moments at home, when the ticking of the clock in the sitting room seemed textured and malign, Ada liked to distract herself by marvelling at the Herculean glumness of Supermarket Kim, a stringy 30-year-old with turquoise pigtails and a reliably complicated constellation of spots on her face, who once told Ada, in a rare 2-minute confession, that she lived over the shop with her mum, literally just above it. So she could take her breaks in bed with Nirvana on loud. But now Kim was looking dejected. She was frozen on the spot like Ada, staring into the middle distance, the tip of one pigtail in her mouth. Only her lips were moving, ruminatively massaging the hair, poking in, pulling more of it into her mouth, as a camel might with a spear of grass. Ada knew at once what Kim's brave new role was, to direct customers to the correct scanner, to check the IDs of the maudlin schoolboys who ricocheted into the shop on Friday nights to pick up crisps and strawberry cider, to punch in her store manager code as and when required, to stoically rescan items that customers misscanned, to make sure that no one was logging pay-by-the-weight pistachios, expensive, as pay-by-the-weight peanuts, less expensive but too salty. Kim was to stand by in silence, the green light of machines blinking enigmatically like Gatsby's pier, waiting for something to go wrong. If she was lucky, the time would go fast. Ada felt the bulk of a person move directly behind her. She realised she was just standing by the machines with her rye bread, blocking the way. She stepped aside. A young woman with pink hair and ripped jeans strode past her, carrying tea and a packet of crumpets. She seemed unfazed by the new checkouts. She went to the nearest one and scanned her items, throwing in a Twix at the last minute. Then she seemed to think better of it and put the Twix back on the shelf. She didn't notice Ada or Kim, who had shifted her weight and was pulling her other pigtail into her mouth with her lips. The young woman collected a receipt, stowed it carefully in a wallet, and breezed towards the exit, leaving Ada agog at her nonchalance, infuriated by it, and envious, too. She realised she was dawdling. She also suspected she might be being melodramatic. This was modernity, that was all. She was just ageing, having trouble adjusting. This was what it meant to be a little old lady who lived on her own. She was playing her role so impeccably she should be proud of herself. These machines were the future. They were sensible and efficient. They would ease the queues that paralysed the shop's aisles, forcing customers to rotate around one another like arthritic dancers. If Michael were here, he'd encourage his wife to embrace the self-checkouts, to make a game of it. They'd miscategorise so many lemons as limes that Kim would have to come over to correct them. Then they'd plead colourblindness and dodderiness and be forgiven. Later, lying down on her bed in Swinburne Road with the curtains drawn, watching the mauve of her eyelids pop and blaze with frightful light, Ada realised it had been the combination of those two things that had set her off. On the one hand, the new machines, which meant a hardier kind of isolation, fewer opportunities for conversation and always off-camera, the chirrup and whir of robotic presence nudging the human out. On the other, the lack of him there, the nonness of Michael, to frame the machine's arrival in a positive light. Ada hadn't realised how much she'd been relying on her daily trips to the shop on Iffley Road to supplement her human diet. Fatima's low laughs at the audacious predictability of Ada's groceries. Milk, rye loaf, tuna, eggs. Ardul's incomprehensible football babble. He supported West or East Ham. The other, less friendly shop attendants whose names Ada didn't know, but who usually tossed a sentence or two her way, which she treasured and pocketed and which kept her going until lunch. And, irrefutably, no Michael with her to find advantages in the change, or see its funny side, or, now she thought of it, as was equally possible, to rage at the implied job losses, at the obliteration of Fatima and Abdul, and the invasion of the machines, even here, in their bourgeois corner of Oxford. Rage was better than her meek devastation, she realised, lying in her bed on Swinburne Road, after she had burst into tears in the shop, by the magazines, waking even Kim from her trance. It ended up being rather the event of both their days. Ada started crying, and Kim took her turquoise pigtails out of her mouth. She came over to lift Ada tenderly from the ground where she'd sunk. She helped Ada out of the shop, as calmly as if this kind of breakdown happened regularly, and they stood by the lamppost outside, with the blue bike chained to it. They were silent for a time, then had a quick chat, a light hug. Kim said that she would have to return inside, and Ada nodded and left, bloodshot and embarrassed, to make the 3-minute journey back to Swinburne Road and her yellow front door, which she unlocked with steady fingers, stepping through the dead house to the bedroom upstairs, listening all the while to the silence of the rooms around her and below her, as if even the walls were carpeted. Chapter 2.
Swinburne Road?
Yeah.
Where's that again?
Iffley.
Near the fish and chip shop?
Kinda. Close to the supermarket. Eliza was shouting. She couldn't remember the name of the bar she'd ended up in, but she liked it. It was badly lit and raucous, and the deal was none of the drinks had set prices. The owner eyed you up, assessed from your demeanour, clothing and accent how much you could afford to pay for your whiskey or whatever, and gave you a price. Most Oxford students, well-heeled southerners who couldn't hide their affluence as much as they tried to beneath Oxfam jackets, paid quite a bit, partly because the owner wanted them to stay away, preferring locals. But Eliza had learned long ago that she oozed hard-upness. Maybe it was in the angles of her face, or her haircut, a pink bob she'd sliced herself, using her phone camera to check the neckline. A Cumbrian accent probably helped too. No one down here thought Northerners had money. In any case, she'd paid £2 for every drink so far, and nothing for the olives. Whereas, the young woman Eliza was shouting her address at had dropped £6 for a vodka tonic. Eliza had been at Oxford for 5 days now, and was trying to throw herself into things. It was technically Freshers' Week, and you saw them everywhere. These shoals of children moving around the city uncertainly, behind student volunteers, tasked with taking them to this curry house or that club. Eliza was 25, but hadn't adjusted yet to not being unarguably young. And she was bemused to find herself noticing the roundness of the freshers' jawlines, the legibility of their unease. When she'd started her undergraduate course at Bath in 2009, had she looked as squashable, as cute? The graduate equivalent of Freshers' Week was less of a thing, but Eliza was still going out as much as she could, beating down the reluctance that rose up her throat every night, ignoring the knowledge that she'd have a better night if she just, you know, stayed in bed. So, here she was with Nat, an undergrad she'd met not 3 hours ago, and had already kissed. They'd started talking in the smoking area of the cellar. Nat was mashed. She was pretty. She seemed to find Eliza funny. After 4 cigarettes on the trot, each drawn from the packet in Nat's backpack, they decided to go on to somewhere else. Nat ordered the cab. Eliza was grateful because she was skint. They kissed on the back seat, like they were in 90210, and pressed their bodies into each other by the entrance to the bar. Nat grabbed Eliza's bum performatively, made her laugh. Now, they were tucked in a corner by the window, and their fingers kept brushing. Eliza's rough eczema hands were mannish, she felt, against Nat's cool, soft brown ones, each painted silver at the end, like she'd dipped them in melted necklaces. "I'm more Summertown way," Nat shouted over the music. "I live with my parents." "Nice," Eliza replied, as loudly. "I've met a few grads who live there, but the rent was mental, so I didn't." "Yeah, the rent is mental. I got a good deal where I am now." "Yeah? There are building works going on. I'm the only tenant in the house. The whole thing's being redone. I think they found asbestos. They're gutting it, except for my room. I'm there to make sure squatters don't move in." "Do you like it?" "Yeah, it's all right. It's not long to get into town." She brought Nat's fingers to her mouth and bit them lightly. Tasted salt. "Do you get woken by builders?" Nat asked. "Sometimes," Eliza said. "I tried to be out the door by 8. She considered adding that there was no hot water in her house, that she showered in the university gym, along with the varsity polo players coming back from training. That living on what was basically a building site meant getting used to a shit ton of dust, and that she'd taken to covering her narrow bed in a shroud of tarpaulin she'd found tangled by an Audi a few doors down. It stopped the particles of dirt from getting into her pillow and blankets. That she woke with a raw throat every morning and had to have lemon and water to loosen it. But she didn't want to put Nat off. And anyway, she was satisfied with how little she was paying for the room, how resourceful she'd been to find it. The developer, Nick, a local who'd got rich off the boom in Oxford property, had advised the room deep in the bowels of a community Facebook page, where he was clearly hoping the authorities wouldn't read it. Eliza had found the ad and called him at once. 5 minutes later, the room was hers. "God!" Nat bellowed. "I'm never up as early as 8. Eliza smiled, shrugging. She thought about making a joke about early birds catching worms, but realised it probably wouldn't be funny. So she said nothing. Nat started massaging her neck across the small table. Her arm was at a weird angle because of their seating positions, but it felt good. Eliza told her so. "You're doing a PhD, right? In Italian lit?" Nat asked. "Yep, just started. They call it a DPhil for some reason. But yeah, basically I'm a creepy grad." Nat gave a mock scream of terror like,
"Ugh!"
They laughed. The divided Oxford between the undergraduate and graduate bodies was almost its own institution. Undergrads regarded doctorate and master's students as lank-haired dweebs who subsisted off lentil bakes and organic wine, and who knew who the local councillors were. Grads pitied the littleness of the undergrads' world, their cliques, their debt, the lameness of their sporting societies, the shallowness of their academic programmes, the fact that they so seldom ventured outside the socially imposed perimeters of the city, never piercing through to real Oxford, its history, its politics, its less photogenic backwaters. But sex was the great unifier, the principal lubricant of grad-undergrad fraternisation. It was socially acceptable, for instance, for an undergrad to pick up a grad on a night out or vice versa. It was even commended as a sign of openness. Maybe it would have been strange for a 30-year-old physics researcher to hit on a fresher who had no idea of anything. But Nat wasn't a fresher, and anyway, the codes were different in the queer scene. Age was policed less, mattered less.
"So, what's the defil actually on?"
Nat asked. "Wait, tell me when I'm back from the loo." She stood up and began to careen to the bathroom, threading her slim body through the people crowding the bar. Eliza lost sight of her. She twisted to watch the road outside. A headlight bloomed white through the night. She swirled her drink. The ice tinkled. She decided she must look like a woman in an Edward Hopper painting, her back ramrod straight, her face unreadable, her body inscrutable beneath her black shift dress.
"I've been everywhere and seen everything and done everything," she thought in an American accent.
After this, Nat would want to come back to Eliza's bedroom. Hers wasn't ideal because she lived with her family. Eliza envisaged opening her bedroom door, with Nat behind her, kneading her neck or her earlobe. Eliza hadn't slept with anyone since Ruby. She wasn't sure, even 18 months later, if she was ready. Or maybe she'd just been conditioned to question whether she could be ready for sex by magazines and TV. Whatever. She and Nat would tip into Eliza's bedroom. They'd be drunker then. They'd have kissed again on the pavement. Eliza would swoop at the tarpaulin on her bed, apologise for the sawdusty smell of the room, and the mugs and the heaters and the cardboard on one of the windows. Nat would say she didn't mind. Add that she liked Eliza's books or something, and they'd kiss more, trying to demonstrate their range and desire. Now lighter, now harder. Maybe this time against the bedroom door. No. No. Not tonight. Eliza stood up. She placed her glass decisively back on the table. It would leave a shining circle on the wood. She put on her anorak, popped one final olive into her mouth, and made her way to the door. Chapter 3. Swinburne Road was like the trip step of Iffley, the southern patch of Oxford arranged around the ancient village that gave the area its name. Most residents didn't know the road was there. Even those who'd grown up in Oxford and remained there their whole lives struggled to place it. They'd frown when Ada said she lived there, narrowing their eyes as if their pension depended upon them successfully incanting the road's longitudinal coordinates. Then finally they'd give up. Everyone knew the roads on either side, Fairacres and Donny Bridge, but Swinburne eluded all. Partly, it was the road's shape, like a sloppy L, with a kind of crescent at one tip that obscured the entrance. Its unremarkable houses were to blame too. Not the tart brick terraces that lined so many of the posh streets of Iffley, but an assortment of white and beige semis. You could have been in virtually any middle-class suburb in England. There weren't many trees. The lampposts lining the road had once been notable. After sunset, they glowed like hot coals, drenching the road in gold. But then the council replaced the orange bulbs with white ones, and even night time lost its mystique. but there were worse places to live. There were several pubs within 10 minutes' walk, an excellent fish and chip shop, a cafe, and, of course, a supermarket, even if Ada was resolved never to shop there again. A few days after she burst into tears at the checkout, she forced herself to go in to see if she could hack it. She'd been raised to get back on a horse if she ever fell off one. But it was too depressing. She rushed out of the shop almost the moment she walked in, deciding she would make her way through bits and pieces from the freezer until she found somewhere better to buy her groceries. When she moved to Oxford with her husband a decade ago, they hadn't put much thought into the address. They were following a job, Michael's, and by then Ada was writing poetry full-time, which was virtually as ill-paid as not having a job at all. His decision to swap a professorship in Manchester for one in Oxford had not been hard. Already in his 60s, he'd been bemused to be offered a post in the prestigious Italian department. He'd not dreamed, like a few of his Manchester colleagues, of making it to Oxbridge, the Premier League of British academia. He was inclined to be content and not to salivate over hypotheticals or dreaming spires. Yet he wasn't lacking in imagination either, or ambition and a sense of adventure. And the offer piqued him when it came. Ada, for her part, was not surprised that Oxford came knocking. Michael was the darling of Manchester's modern languages department. He wrote a book every 2 years, and each was well received by the top peer-reviewed journals. He spoke on Radio 4 about the importance of literature and languages. His classes on giants from D'Annunzio to Croce, Pirandello to Moravia, were the best rated in undergraduate surveys. His lectures the most packed. Ada used to sit in sometimes. That was how they'd met. She'd watched a panel he was on at Exeter all those years ago, and he'd directed his words entirely, or so it had seemed, at her. When she went to his lectures in Manchester, she saw the way the undergrads around her leaned forward to listen, tapping at their laptops to ensure his sentences lodged uncreased in the annals of their word processors. But it had always been a skill of Michael's, or his peculiar curse, not to notice his own quality. It was a form of tone deafness. You could have bellowed words of affirmation at his face and he wouldn't have taken them in. And so the summons from Oxford came, for him, if for nobody else, out of the blue. Ada was happy to move. She liked Manchester, but Oxford too would surely be pleasant. She packed up their life and friendships with goodwill. The books and art and crockery came with them. The furniture, bought for nothing in charity shops, stayed behind. They sold Ivy Cottage and the stable next door and found the house in Swinburne Road through someone in the Oxford Portuguese department, who was off to UCLA. Got in before it was put on the market. They were lucky. Ada sold her shares, Michael scraped out the last of his savings, and they found a way. The day after moving in, they walked to the hardware shop on Magdalen Road and bought some paint. Michael chose the colour. Ada dug out two aprons, and they spent their first afternoon in Oxford turning their new front door blistering yellow. It was an overcast day in August, but warm enough. Michael managed to leave a kidney-shaped palm print by the knocker. "Darling," Ada rebuked him, her voice gentle. You could see the lines of his skin in the paint. The patch looked matte, while the rest of the door glistened wetly.
"When I die, you'll have something to remember me by," Michael replied.
Ada rolled her eyes but didn't paint over the mark. They spent the rest of the afternoon in the garden, picking cherries from the tree that had been kept in life by academics passing through the house before them. There were nettles around the base of the trunk. Ada cut them back, saving the younger leaves for soup. That night, she and Michael read and ate in the sitting room, cardboard boxes all around them like Tetris blocks. Now, Ada lived on Swinburne Road alone. Under the stairs, she remembered sometimes, was the tin of yellow paint. They'd only used half. After the door was finished, Ada suggested they throw the remainder away.
They certainly couldn't use it on the indoor walls. Their eyeballs would peel. But Michael insisted they keep the paint. It would do, he said, to jolly up the bench under the cherry tree. They never got round to it, of course, and cast the tin into the cupboard. There it was still. Ada wondered sometimes if the gloop inside had hardened into a kind of radioactive spherical brick. She hadn't touched the paint since Michael had died. She was afraid of its distinctive tang, of its brightness. In the months afterwards, when Ada felt less like her heart was being pulled from her chest through the small of her back, she became to be rather proud of how ordinarily her husband had died. At the kitchen table, on a flat morning in March 2014. A paper open on the table, a fiendish Sudoku half done, biro in hand. As his heart stopped beating, Ada was in a deep sleep upstairs. It thinned out as morning wove itself around her new situation. At 8, she woke properly and sat up. Soon, she'd hear the muffle of Michael's steps in the kitchen as he poured milk into a jug and prepared a cafetière to bring up to her. There were no such sounds today, but that too was routine. Sometimes, Michael went for a morning walk to the river to watch the rowers pump past on the water. Most of all, he liked seeing the cocks at the tip of the boat, bundled up and tiny. Her voice, it was often a she, strident in the dawn air. Ada found her reading glasses and shook out a fortnight-old copy of the London Review of Books. She picked up where she'd left off the night before. Column 3, in a piece about the vagaries of the Arab Spring. For a while, she tried following the thread of the article, but it was no good. She'd need to start from the beginning. Even the names of the movement's leaders were getting mixed up, and she couldn't remember who was uprising against whom. Finally, she cast the paper aside, feeling thick. She found her dressing gown and went downstairs. On mornings when Michael went to the river, she made them boiled eggs. On his return, they'd eat them together in the garden, their laps weighed down with blankets they'd piled by the back door. On his return, they would eat them together in the garden, their laps weighed down with blankets they piled by the back door. But this morning was different. Ada entered the kitchen to find Michael seated, not filling the kettle or scattering coffee beans all over the counter. His forehead was on the wood of the kitchen table, as if, Ada thought unaccountably as she observed him, he'd been assassinated from behind by a Soviet spy. He was not moving. His coffee was warm. Heart attack, she discovered later. Killed instantly. 75. Younger than many, but not so young Ada felt she had the right to complain. Ada sat with his body for an hour, then surprised herself by standing up to call her sister. She spoke plainly, delivering the salient points of the story with no wet breakdowns. Eve came up to Oxford at once on the train. She lived in Brighton with her daughter, Gwen, who had been left by her husband 18 months before. There were grandchildren, Ali and Tom, 6 and 7, beautiful creatures with white blonde hair. They were growing too fast, Eve said. She turned out to be a great help, emailing authorities from Michael's old computer, buying sleeping pills and bread, arranging for a note to be put in the paper. Ada sensed vaguely that she would come to appreciate her sister's efforts at a later point. She liked Eve, though they were not close. As children, they'd been sent to different schools. Ada was saved by the local grammar. Eve failed the 11 plus, so went to the comp. In their separate tracks, they lost the intimacy of childhood. At one time, they'd looked so similar they were mistaken for twins, and they used to spend their time doing twin things, pretending to be one another, drawing matching moles on their cheekbones. It's a strange thing, Ada informed her at the memorial. Michael had had the good grace to die outside of term time, so there had been no issues persuading Balliol, his college, to host the service. 100 people came. What's a strange thing? Eve asked, holding Ada's arm.
They were walking out of the chapel through the fellow's garden. The day was full of light, and the spring flower beds, maintained by the college gardeners, were chattering with colour.
Death, Ada said. It's strange.
They were nearly at the buttery before either of them spoke again.
Do you mean it's strange because you keep expecting Michael to walk through the door?
Eve asked softly. 1 minute he's here, the next is...
I suppose, Ada replied.
She laughed.
I suppose there's that.
Of course.
One does expect him to just turn up.
But I'm also having trouble gripping what it is exactly that I've lost. During the memorial service, one of the organ pedals had jammed, sending a note resounding through the chapel like a foghorn. Everyone stopped singing, How Great Thou Art, and whipped round excitedly to ogle the organist. The few children in the chapel clapped their hands to their ears and stared dolefully up at the ceiling. The note only ceased when the provost hurried up to the organ and stamped on the offending pedal, dislodging it. Michael, Ada knew, would have loved the disruption. He wasn't a believer, but he'd been brought up in Dublin and accepted that religion ran deep in him, like one of those secret springs beneath a city. There was no use resisting. Unless he went to church regularly, he got twitchy. He recited his prayers. He inhaled the pew musk of cathedral buildings. He kneeled on their flagstones. But a hatred of it all ran deep in him too, alongside the tenderness. And he brought Quality Street to Mass, disrobing golden pennies at the quietest moment. An organ acting up was just the sort of low-level rebellion he respected. He would have loved to hear such a cock-up at his own memorial.
I get sudden stabs of him, Ada said, like when the organ broke in the chapel. I could imagine his reaction, and I knew fully for a second the person that he was. But the rest of the time...
She shrugged. Eve squeezed her hand. Ada could feel her nails printing half-moons into the palm of her hand. Ada waded through the rest of the day as if enveloped in her own personal smog. Occasionally, people or words pierced through.
A wonderful man.
I can't tell you just how...
The kindest.
When she looked up to link the sounds to their speaker, invariably they'd been reclaimed by the crowd. She was left holding the phrases in her hands, carefully, like injured birds. She was glad of one thing, that she'd had the foresight to demand, on the invitations that were sent out all over the country, that guests wear yellow. Most obeyed, but the lure of tradition was strong, too, and they kowtowed to it by supplementing their vibrant clothing with black. Throughout the service, and at the bleak little reception afterwards, Ada had the impression she was in some sort of hive, and that most of the bees were jostling towards her to buzz their condolence. The daffodil season was cresting, too, and every chest was pinned with flowers, their luminous heads nodding gravely in the close air. Eve left for Oxford railway station the day after Michael's memorial. As the taxi waited for her outside, she asked if Ada would like to come with her. Stay with the family in Brighton for a while. Be surrounded by noise and youth. There was space, and Ali and Tom needed constant attention. There was no need for her to remain alone if she didn't want to. Ada listened to the offer. At 19, she'd learned that she would never bear children, and being around them for prolonged periods unsettled her even now. She didn't know who to be, what to make of their stares and sudden emergencies. She liked Gwen and Eve and the children, but she missed Michael too much, she realised, to let go of their Oxford life yet, of their home, of its precise configuration of lamps and delicate ornaments. She'd kept herself together so far, partly to respect Eve's time and care. She wanted to luxuriate in her grief now. She said she'd be fine staying where she was. She said she needed to start afresh on her own, if such a thing were possible. She said no. Eve nodded, kissed her sister on the cheek, stroked her hair, and left. They spoke some time later, as leaves were nosing from branch joints in the cherry tree, until Ali leapt onto her grandmother's lap, and the phone fell to the ground. Ada disconnected before Eve picked up the handset. Chapter 4. Eliza had never ghosted anyone before. As she steeled herself to do it, to walk away from the bar while Nat was in the bathroom, she suddenly realised she hated herself for even considering it. It would be embarrassingly melodramatic to just cut and run while Nat was having a pee. She returned inside, sat down, and crossed her legs as if nothing had happened. Nat came back from the bathroom. Her lipstick looked shiny. She didn't notice Eliza's hair was damp from the rain outside. The night didn't turn out the way Eliza expected. She and Nat kissed for a bit, where they were sat, but it wasn't the sort of bar to get handsy in. So they soon felt weird about it and gave up. Eliza bought them more drinks. She stopped comparing Nat to Ruby, then stopped worrying about whether Nat would come back to Swinburne Road, with all the implications that carried. Instead, she listened to what Nat was saying. All of it was interesting, and most of it was funny. Nat was in her second year of history and was leading a group of students working to end university examinations, which they believed favoured peacock thinkers trained to show off under pressurised conditions. Privileged white men performed better in time-constrained situations than women did, so the reasoning went. Only they didn't know as much. They winged it, as they had done for fucking millennia. Exams were bigoted. Off with their heads. Eliza didn't think exams were bigoted, but she did like the term peacock thinkers, and told Nat so. They said it to one another again and again in different accents, laughing and clinking their glasses. Then Nat said she'd better get home. Eliza was surprised and relieved. She waited with her for the bus. She'd not imagined Nat was the bus type, and walked home. It was raining still, but some of the weight had come off it. She pulled the toggles of her anorak hood tight, leaving a slit around her eyes. Her shift dress felt dry and warm underneath. When she got home, the buildings on Swinburne Road were dark. It was 2 in the morning, and felt like it must be everywhere. Only the house opposite Eliza's, with a front door that glowed yellow in daylight, seemed alert. A room upstairs was lit. Eliza could make out the silhouette of a person standing by the window behind thin curtains. She watched the figure for a moment from the pavement, then fished her key out of her backpack, shouldered her way past the bags of cement in the front garden, and opened the back door, the only way in. She walked up to her bedroom, her throat rough from the dirty air, and curled up on her bed. When Eliza awoke the next morning, she was momentarily disorientated by the crisp packet crinkle of the tarpaulin she was lying on. Her phone was dead. It took her a minute to remember she'd left a bike outside Cellar, the club she'd met Nat in. Footage from the night came back to her in bursts of movement and sound. She was still in her dress. She stood up and looked at her reflection, putting her phone on charge. Her mascara looked clumpy. But it would do. She gulped down some tea left over in a mug and pulled on her Nikes. New College, the college she was attached to as a grad student, was 30 minutes walk away. If she wanted to buy a coffee before meeting the bursar, she'd need to jog. She crammed a mini muffin into her mouth from the packet by the window and left. Outside, she looked curiously at number 24 opposite. She didn't know who lived there. Eliza knew none of her neighbours, but she remembered how ghostly the house had appeared the night before, its shadows and lit upper room, the person she'd seen behind the curtain. Now, the building seemed ordinary, inconsequential. She swung her backpack on and began to run half-heartedly towards the centre. Eliza first went around New College with her dad, Rich, a couple of months before getting an offer. They woke up at 5 and hammered down the A6 in the Volvo. Eliza's mother, Flora, didn't come. She and Rich weren't close, and the last time Eliza had talked to her mother, they'd argued. Flora had heard that Eliza had won £500 in an essay competition, and she'd asked for a slice of it. Eliza had said no, and they'd not communicated since. Oxford was about a 5-hour drive from Carlisle. Eliza didn't get car sick, so much as car trodden. More than 20 minutes in one made her feel weak and insipid, like she'd given blood. Rich wanted to chat the whole way down, to stop off for McDonald's and service station sprees, for the journey to become one big road trip. Eliza knew she ought to want those things, that it was lovely of Rich to be making the effort to drive her, but the petrol was expensive, and he could have been finishing the Kane's garden. But she couldn't bring herself to be warm and gossipy, especially after the dawn start.
Crush test dummies or meatloaf?
Rich asked eventually, holding up two battered albums, one hand on the steering wheel. Eliza considered. Dummies, please, she said, looking out of the window. She preferred to see the countryside from a car than to be actually in it. She kept her eyes peeled for walkers going through the fields. She liked imagining the idyll of their lives, their argers and the trim dogs they named after characters in Shakespeare. In Oxford, they tried to see 15 colleges in about 6 hours. Rich had left school at 16 and was exhilarated. Eliza, not so much. She wanted to get into the university. Its Italian department was excellent. If she completed her doctorate here, a career in academia might be within reach. But she couldn't untangle the knots of revulsion she felt at the whole Oxford shtick. The gardens, the wanky cello concertos advertised everywhere, the plinths and dead-eyed statues and rowing oars on display in college bars. It was like Bath on steroids. Rich wanted to banter with every porter, admire every oak, take Earl Grey and scones in every hokey tea room lining the streets of the city centre. He kept squeezing Eliza's shoulders as they walked through this archway or that chapel. And soon, the colleges and faculties garbled into one, a great bonfire of mahogany and wealth and honey-coloured stone. "Why aren't you excited?" Rich kept asking. "We're at Hogwarts. You love Hogwarts." This was true. Eliza had spent much of her childhood in Rowling's Castle, watching Ron stuff his face with fried eggs in the Great Hall, dropping in on Hagrid near the forest. "But it's like a Disneyland version of Hogwarts," she tried to explain. "It's like Hogwarts is the real thing, and this is the fake version. None of the buildings look real. Even the cyclists look like they're actors in a period drama." As she spoke, an Eddie Redmayne lookalike wobbled past on a Dutch cycle, a bunch of flowers in his front basket. Rich shook his head, smiling. He didn't bother trying to understand. He'd begun to measure the difference between himself and his only child when she was 4 years old, and it had only widened with every year. He was pragmatic, positive, robust. Eliza was puzzling, hurtable, prone to emotional crises Rich couldn't unravel. When Eliza got a scholarship to a boarding school in Surrey, aged 13, his sense of alienation from the young woman she was becoming grew still further. She would return home from St. Antonia's in the holidays, and every time she felt more unknowable, more distant, and always less willing to reveal who her posh new friends were, what the teaching was like, whether it was a pain to go to chapel every day. Then her accent started to deaden. One Christmas, Rich teased her about it, said she was talking like Princess Margaret, and Eliza didn't say a word for the rest of the day. He learned the next term, at a parent-teacher weekend, that Eliza was being hassled because of her accent. Other girls hid her belongings, made her say words like "I'll do" and "butter" until she could get her stuff back. Rich tried to persuade Eliza to come back north, shine in a less academic school, cut the snobs loose. She said no, the teaching was too good to pass up. She knew that her father loved her extravagantly, and was proud of her difference from him, of her single-mindedness and intellect, and that when he could only look at Eliza and wonder at the fact that he hadn't a clue what she was thinking. He felt a strange fizzle of joy that he could have played a hand in creating such an enigma. They visited Oxford out of term time. Most students they saw were grads, but there were one or two younger students still in town who'd stuck around to do tour guiding, or telethon, as they wearily called it, where they were paid to call up alumni and press for donations. The best tour they had was of Trinity College, where an Irish student called Saoirse spent 10 minutes showing them the libraries, the music rooms, and a few sets, or, as she translated for them, bedrooms with living rooms attached. She seemed so perfectly bored by the exigencies of the tour that Eliza couldn't help but admire her. There was something ghoulish in the happy-clappy students wearing college stash and going wild for the Wi-Fi speed. After a sandwich outside the Radcliffe Camera, they visited New College. There were no guides hanging around the entrance, waiting for prospective students to show around. So Eliza and Rich visited the college unaccompanied. Rich read aloud from a pamphlet he'd picked up by the chapel. By then it was raining softly, a breath sort of rain, and the grass in the quadrangles shone as if every blade had been licked.
New College was founded in 1379 by William of Wickham, Rich read from beneath his umbrella. It often ranks first in the Norrington tables. Lies! That means it's academically top dollar. You'll fit in.
They chose random staircases to climb. The doors were heavy and old. Once they found themselves in a student's unlocked bedroom. Clothes were all over the floor, and a snake was looped around itself in a glass tank. Rich and Eliza stared around. Then the student himself appeared in a towel, his white torso sparkling from a shower. They apologised and beat a retreat to the second quadrangle to meet with New College's head of Italian. His name was Davide Baleotti. He looked about 40, with boyish tufts of black hair. He'd grown up partly in the Congo and had gone down with polio. He moved now with a stick and a degree of awkwardness. Baleotti was well known in the tight-knit world of 20th century Italian literary criticism. Eliza admired him so much, she felt nervous to see him in the flesh. He was like her, an Elsa Morante fanatic, and reading him dissect writers, Eliza thought she knew back to front, was like walking along a forest path you loved, and finding it suddenly illuminated by lances of sunlight, motes of air swirling in the brightness. Baleotti offered them the sofa by the fireplace.
"Your name?"
he asked, resting his stick on his knees. "Eliza Fender," Eliza said. She told him she knew his work, that she had studied Italian at Bath, and was looking to start a PhD at Oxford in the autumn. She wondered if she was gabbling. Rich often told her off for her millennial mumble. And anyway, most Italians had trouble with any accent north of London. But Baleotti seemed to understand what she'd said. He launched himself upwards, haphazardly, and started rummaging around on his desk.
"This is your paper," he cried. "You are the Eliza Fender who did this."
Eliza squinted. Then she grinned. The professor was waving a copy of the latest Italian literary review. 2 months ago, the journal had printed her essay on Primo Levi. "Yeah?" she said, not knowing what else to say. Baleotti whacked the paper with his hand, so enthusiastically he looked almost furious.
"It is brilliant," he cried.
Shouted, really.
"It has been on my mind ever since the journal came out."
Eliza felt her pleasure at his words unfurl luxuriously within her. She nodded and smiled and thanked him, Rich looking on in throes of excitement. Baleotti said that he would be seeing her in the autumn, come what may. They tried to leave. Baleotti blocked the door, telling Eliza he had some books that she'd enjoy. In a great burst of energy, he began acrobating over the columns of tomes teetering on this side table and that chest of drawers. And before long, Eliza could barely see for the pile of books and DVDs that he'd put in her arms. She rested her chin on the top item, an eco-feminist reading of Zeno's Conscience, thanked the professor for his time, and left. Rich, in reluctant tow.
"He thought you were brilliant,"
he marvelled, as they walked back through the quad. Eliza said nothing. The paper Baleotti had remembered was a reading of Primo Levi's own readings, an exploration of the books that had shaped him as a writer. She wanted to continue working on Levi over the course of her doctorate. That seemed possible, suddenly, and desirable. And for the first time in months she felt puckish, with a sense of her own talent. She might have a direction at last. They made their way to the Volvo. Rich was due in the Kane's garden the following morning. On the way up, Eliza looked out for walkers again, for the bound of their animals, the quiet conversation she could almost overhear, and certainly invent, about Russian novels they were reading, and the hot fish pies they were planning on cooking for tea. Chapter 5. One morning in October, Ada noticed that something had changed in the house opposite. The previous occupants had sold it to a developer, who was gutting the building, but now someone seemed to have moved into the bedroom upstairs. Ada wondered vaguely if the new occupant was a squatter. Her interest in the street, once keener than she'd have freely admitted, was now minimal. Without Michael, Swinburne Road seemed cored. She was reading on her armchair when she looked up, detecting activity in the house opposite. She rushed to the window, intrigued in spite of herself. A young woman was walking into the building, using a battered side door Ada assumed led to the garden. She watched, gripped, trying to judge whether the young woman was moving with any degree of furtiveness. Her pink hair certainly made her look like a trespasser. But no, it seemed she had a key. Ada felt slightly ashamed of herself. A second later, the girl was inside the house. Ada returned to her reading, pleased that something had happened, and that she'd witnessed it for once, and wondering why it was that young people liked to dye their hair such eye-watering shades of unnatural. That afternoon, she roused herself for the first time in months to make a loaf of soda bread. She used to bake, lots. Feeding Michael had been almost a job in its own right, and above all, he liked soda bread, preferably straight from the oven. As it was baking, she composed letters she'd been meaning to write for weeks. One to Eve, her sister in Brighton, and a couple to friends who lived hundreds of miles from Oxford. She was out of practice. She received fewer letters now. In the weeks following Michael's death, she'd never known post like it. That was what happened to newly minted widows, she learned. People liked to mark the occasion, to uncap fountain pens they rarely used, and do something with stamps left over from Christmas. In all, within a month of Michael's death, she received 62 cards. At the time, she wanted to know whether that was a decent head count, but she didn't have anyone in a similar situation to ask. She displayed the cards on mantelpieces around the house, patiently putting them back up again when drafts tipped them shut. Letters weren't the only thing. The secretary of the Italian department, Alessandra, came round 5 weeks after the memorial to sort out bits of admin. She brought wine and a bundle of printed-out emails. "These were sent to me, and some of the rest in the department," she said, once the worst of the paperwork was out of the way. "They're about Mike. They're emails from his students, mostly. I thought you might want the physicals." "Young people send letters less now," Ada nodded.
"Exactly," Alessandra replied.
She was about 30, from Cordoba, a kind woman with light brown eyes and jangly bracelets. Ada imagined Michael had spoken about her before. She looked at the A4 sheet. They didn't look like much. Are they nice messages? She asked.
They're lovely, Alessandra said.
They spoke for a while about other things. Funding issues, the department, building works dragging out near the faculty building. Ada found the conversation quite exhausting. Alessandra told her that she could come back to visit Ada if she wanted her to. She asked in a rush how she was managing, whether she had a support network, if she was writing poetry. Ada's last collection, Things Considered, had come out a few months before Michael's death. Ada assured her she was doing fine, that she got out most days, that she wasn't writing, but that it would come, that it was a blessing having the river nearby. The rowers, the houseboats, the fussy cygnets.
Do you have plans to move out?
Alessandra asked as she stood up to leave. Ada looked at her blankly. She felt a coldness encase her chest.
Why would I? She asked.
Alessandra looked uncomfortable. They were in the kitchen. Alessandra's eyes flicked to the table. She must have known they'd been sitting where Michael had died.
Well, she murmured, perhaps it's a big house and...
I'm going to stay put, thank you, Ada said curtly. Alessandra nodded. She was embarrassed. They walked to the front door. Ada extended a hand for her to shake. Alessandra pulled her into a hug. It was apologetic and brief, an angular affair of elbows and cheekbones. Ada felt invaded. She wished her body had been left to itself. Once Alessandra had smiled one final time, she left. Ada stood for a moment in the hallway, her eyes closed. Alessandra's bracelets tinkled down Swinburne Road as she walked to her car. Ada double-locked the front door and returned to the sitting room. The curtains needed closing and the lamp switching on. Once the lighting was right, she set herself up in her armchair to read the emails. Leaving them to fester would be childish. To prevent herself from breaking down, she tried to make it fun. She looked out for emails that were sent at night, looking to correlate lateness with incoherence. When she saw one sent by a Professor McDougall from Dundee, she read it aloud in a Scottish accent. She laughed aloud at one email, which was, by accident or intent, in iambic pentameter. But the messages of goodwill quickly began to slur into one. Condolences were the same as sympathies, really. It was all very thoughtful. It was all very heartfelt. Lots of people were calling Michael Mike, which was vexing, and referring to his character traits in such slack-jawed ways that the word seemed unmoored from the man Ada was looking for in the emails. And none of the messages could address the issue that Michael wasn't in the kitchen at that moment.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.